We're joined today by Richard Hay. Richard is a partner at Strikeman Elliott LLP in London, where he specializes in international tax law. Richard advises financial institutions and private clients on tax, regulation, and cross-border estate planning. He advises the International Financial Center Forum and is also a member of the STEP Public Policy Committee. Richard, I'd like to start today, if I may, with tax information exchange. TIE is a fact of life for many of KYC 360's members, but others will be unfamiliar with the concept. What is the problem that tax information exchange is looking to solve?
Well, I think particularly since the financial crisis, governments have felt pressure on their tax collection systems. They put pressure on the domestic environment to fully comply with taxation, and they want to be able to demonstrate to the public that even the larger companies and individuals are being closely supervised around the world in their tax affairs in order to enhance public support for the tax collection process.
Sticking with tax information exchange, I wonder if you could give us a brief sketch of what it is, how it developed over time, and how it operates today.
Okay. Well, historically, countries were not obliged to help each other collect taxes. That changed at OECD country level in the 50s and 60s when the larger countries concluded double tax agreements with each other that facilitated cross-border information exchange. But since the small offshore centers in particular did not get treaty networks, which typically confer benefits of lowered withholding tax and various other appealing elements. By the time they got to 2000 and European countries began to sense issues with their public finances, they felt they needed mechanisms that would facilitate cross-border information exchange to those centers which did not have double tax treaties. So tax information exchange agreements were developed as an abbreviated double tax agreement. Some would see it as something which imposes all of the burdens and none of the benefits. And these started to be concluded initially by the United States after 9/11 with the Caribbean countries and then with other countries through the middle part of the last decade. So the British offshore centers would have concluded quite a number of these between 2007 or 8 and the present, although they're seen as somewhat outmoded now in the sense that they require a government seeking information to make a prima facie case for the information, and the number of exchanges has actually been relatively small, and onshore governments are now pushing for much more comprehensive information exchange.